Hey, what's up, Grio fam? It's your girl, Natasha. We're here on the couch at CultureCon with the Terence Nance. What's up, Terence? How you feeling?
I'm all right. I'm just a Terence Nance. There's other Terence Nance.
Listen, when I talk to people about random acts, I've heard things like zero f's given, like nothing they've ever seen. How did y'all get this on TV? Tell me, how did you do it? How did you really get this on TV?
I think HBO is definitely looking for work that pushed past what they've done before. You know, I think that their brand is always to kind of up the ante creatively. And so I think that we had that in our favor going in, because from our perspective, the show's not that crazy, you know, politically or anything. I don't think it embodies anything that would be shocking to you or I, you know what I mean? Like, and what we're talking about, but it's sort of like, feel shocking based on what we expect kind of middle America to be responding to or not. But at the end of the day, like, you know, they may or may not watch it. And it's sort of like, it's a conversation between you and I, essentially. And I think that the truth of that conversation is evident in the show. I think that, like, somebody like HBO, they could read that, you know, the truth is there and they want to put it on TV.
Talk about the birth of the idea. Like, how did it start and grow and evolve into the format in which we're seeing it?
Well, the first iteration of the show was written down in 2006 when I was in college. So around that time, my younger brother, who's a writer and a director and a composer on the show as well, he had an idea to try and convince TV1 at the time, which was all reruns at the time, to let us take over their kind of like late night time, because it was like, you know, we just put everything we want to on there. And I think that, like, maybe something related to that is why I wrote it, but I think there was also just like, I had made some short films I thought would fit in kind of like a TV show format like this. So I wrote the idea, but I never really, it was so long ago, I don't remember exactly what was on my mind at the time, but I think it was something related to that kind of energy.
Yeah. Okay, so while I have you on the couch, I want to get the inside scoop on two things that we saw in the show. Ripper the Reaper, yeah. Right? Jolly, terrifying at the same time. For a viewer who's watching this for the first time and trying to make sense of what she represents, for you, what does she represent?
Well, shout out to Nuatama Bodomo, who wrote and directed that piece, and Mariama Diallo, who co-wrote it, both writers and directors on the show. And so, like, I'm kind of in the same position you are, you know, like, as an audience member, essentially, you know, watching that piece. And how I read it is, you know, she's representing the many layers of emotion that we as a people confront when we're confronted with the state murdering us and, like, murdering our children with impunity. And I think the layers of those emotions are always obviously like anger, horror, but then when you're kind of like in a position where there's no direct route to justice or anything productive, then that anger and horror can turn to absurdity, and then that absurdity can obviously turn to delirium, and that delirium can obviously turn to laughter. And I think that, like, Tanya's performance of Ripper the Reaper is sort of a meta way of exploring that idea that, like, you know, she's the arbiter of death, but even in that position, you know, she can't help but engage with the absurdity of, like, the untimely death of these black children, you know. So I think that that emotional state, that confrontation to the absurdity, mirrors my own emotional journey with that reality, with our reality, you know.
Speaking of emotions, I got really emotional at one point watching the show. For the first time, I saw Afro-Latinos kind of represented in a black culture conversation, the Never Never Land scene where we saw people singing in Spanish. What was the conversation around that? I know that there are writers who obviously had a role in that, but were you being intentional about making sure that all, you know, a diversity of black experience was in the show?
Yeah, I mean, it goes back to authorship. We have Afro-Latinx writers and directors on the show. Naima Ramos-Chapman is from Flatbush. It's a representation of, you know, her world, you know. And at the end of the day, there's more of them than us. There's more African descended people who speak Spanish than there are African.
A lot of people don't know that.
English. Yeah. Like, way more. And if you include Portuguese in that, then there's no competition. So, like, really, blackness is Latinness, you know what I mean? Like, they're part and parcel to each other, more so than blackness is American, or not even more so, but as much at least. And so I think that reality, you know, something that maybe a lot of people aren't aware of, because, you know, we don't necessarily, as a people, get to engage with media from that espouses the Africanness. But you know, if you listen to salsa music, it's that Afro-Latino culture. You know what I mean? Like it's, if you know, reggaeton or anything. You know, like zouk, like all of this has a kind of common point of gestation in African culture. And so I think that reality, both how present Afro-Latino culture is in New York, but then also how present it is in all Black experiences, you know, because it's foundational, you know, it's essentially, it's just really important, you know. The first people who arrived here arrived in the Caribbean and South America, you know what I mean? So, like, first Black people. So I think it's just important to affirm that, you know?
Yeah, that means a lot to me. I'm African-American and Puerto Rican, so just seeing that, like, is mind-blowing. Okay, so Terence, as a young child, what were you like creatively? Were you like drawing on the walls? Were you writing scripts? Like, what were you doing as cultivating that talent early on?
You'd have to ask my mom or my dad. I really don't know. I mean, I definitely wasn't writing scripts. I was very quiet, you know, as a kid, and I definitely drew. And drawing was something that, you know, like every kid has a thing they can do well without having to work too hard at it. Drawing was the thing I could do well without having to work too hard at it, you know? So I think I had that kind of led me down a path in a certain way, because I recognized just my kind of innate gift with that. But I definitely wasn't, I think I have always been engaged with the idea of performance and performing because everybody in my family are performers and found a lot of joy in that. I definitely feel like I repressed that a little bit as a kid, and like I'm just now kind of exploring that more fully, you know?
It's interesting that you say you're just now exploring it. You know, a lot of people will come to this conference and want to know how to get started, or they may feel like it's too late. What do you say to somebody who's just starting out and they have an idea, but again, it's so nascent, you know, it's so young. How do you encourage them to see it through?
I mean, it's just a lie. You know, at the end of the day, you know, Toni Morrison didn't write The Blue Side until she was in her 30s and already had a kid. You know, she's the greatest novelist on planet Earth probably ever to have existed. Walter Mosley, the same. He was a computer programmer until he was in his 30s. He's one of the most prolific, you know, writers of our times. And, you know, there's just so many examples of people who, you know, didn't necessarily find the whatever you need to find to consistently have a practice of making work until, quote unquote, later in life. You know, but that in no way invalidates, you know, or handicaps even, you know, anybody's capacity to build a practice. I think that like the idea of building a practice of making work is not something that everybody is going to have access to. And I think that we as a culture have this idea that like if you don't build a practice of it, making work, then you failed in some way. I think more is like maybe you haven't failed, maybe that's just a journey of desires that you need to go through to get to whatever it is that you want to do. But if it is life or death for you to make artwork, at whatever point you want to start it, there's no such thing as too late, obviously, as per like all the examples of people starting whenever they can get it together, you know?
Yeah. So basically keep going.
Yeah, keep going, you know.
Thank you so much for creating this. Thank you for opening up our world, and we wish you the best. Can't wait for the second season.
Yeah, me neither.